This evening on The Rock Newman Show, Dr. Sheila Walker is a cultural anthropologist and filmmaker known for tracing the roots and history of the slave trade. She'll discuss the contributions of the African diaspora in the New World and beyond. That's coming up right now on The Rock Newman Show. Welcome to The Rock Newman Show from the campus of historic Howard University located in the nation's capital. I'm Rock Newman, and it is my desire to inspire you with personal stories of extraordinary achievement. Dr. Sheila Walker has spent a lot of time over the years visiting communities of African descendants all around the world. She's been to South Carolina, Brazil, El Salvador, and Turkey, to name a few. Here's an interview that she conducted in India.
When you see black Americans, what do you think?
Black American and we are brothers.
Why?
Why
are you brothers? Your brothers just because you're black?
I do same like this. Black hair, skin.
Thank you. So welcome, and thank you so very much for joining us tonight.
Thank you. I'm glad to be here.
First, I described in the opening that Dr. Sheila Walker was a cultural anthropologist.
Indeed.
In the words of my beloved mom, what do that mean?
I wrote an article for Essence magazine in the early 70s. Yeah. When Essence had just begun, and it was called something like Anthropology, What's That?
Mm-hmm.
And one of the things I explained was, well, now, when I say I'm an anthropologist, people say, oh, that's very interesting, uh-huh.
Mm-hmm.
So you dig up all those bones and things,
mm-hmm.
and I say, no, I'm a cultural anthropologist, live people.
Uh-huh.
I want people who sing, dance, eat, and mm-hmm. so what I study is culture. What do we do? What are our ceremonies? What do we eat? That's part of culture. How do we talk? How
mm-hmm.
do we use our bodies?
Mm-hmm.
So it's human behavior in groups, identity. Well, that's cultural anthropology, but I don't dig and I don't get my fingernails dirty.
I asked you about South Carolina and Geechee country.
Mm-hmm.
And you made a reference, and you said, something there I noticed that the body language was African.
Mm-hmm.
What does that mean?
Well, the first place I went was Dafuski Island. And that's, I think it's the most remote island. At that point, there was no public transportation.
Mm-hmm.
I had to go, somebody had to pick me up on mm-hmm. the mainland.
Mm-hmm.
And first of all, there's the language factor.
Yes.
When I called Mr. Jake, he said, let me let you talk to my son. You'll yeah. understand him better.
Uh-huh. Uh-huh.
So Mr. Jake came, got me, took me to Miss Bertha's, with whom I stayed. And when I got to her house, she was sitting in front of the house with food in a bowl. She was eating with, she had her legs spread like an older woman has the right to do.
Mm-hmm.
She had her head tied up,
okay.
and okay. she was eating out of the bowl with a tablespoon.
Okay.
And it was something like catfish and grits
uh-huh.
with gravy.
Mercy.
And I thought, I've seen this woman in Cameroon.
Yeah. yeah.
eating out of the bowl
uh-huh.
with the spoon or her hands.
Uh-huh.
With her, we picked okra. Yeah. I've never picked okra. I'm from Jersey. We don't pick okra.
Okay.
her companion, Mr. Thomas, started telling stories about Big Massa and the critters. And
okay.
I thought, wow, animal stories.
Yeah.
You know, that's
yeah.
where we get like Br'er Rabbit
mm-hmm.
stuff. So I thought, wow, this is a piece of Africa, detached.
Uh-huh. And you know what, that just really walks me right into what is another question. We hear the word oftentimes, the African diaspora. And Define that for us. Define diaspora for us.
Okay, it's a word I like. Okay. And it's very simple. Okay. Dia, like diameter, across.
Uh-huh.
Spora, like the spores on a fern.
Okay.
When the wind blows, the spores, the seeds of the fern, plant themselves.
Yeah.
So it's the replanting of people outside of their original homeland.
Mm-hmm.
So the replanting of people of African origin around the world. So to sow, S-O-W, like sowing seeds,
sure.
To sow across. So uh-huh. We've been sown across the world.
Uh-huh. And indeed Africans have.
Yeah, absolutely, from the beginning.
You were a 19-year-old student at Bryn Mawr College, just outside of Philadelphia.
Mm-hmm.
When you took your first international trip, you went to Cameroon. So if you could walk us back to that time, that having been an African American student, let me see, and when you were there, you weren't African American, you were black or Negro.
I wasn't black.
Uh-huh.
I was Negro or colored.
You were Negro or colored
right.
When you were in college.
Yeah.
Okay. And so then, and you were one of two, but the other one left and left you
alone.
Solo
right.
As the only colored Negro.
Exactly.
At that college. You leave there and you go to Cameroon. Tell us about that visit to Cameroon and how it changed your perspective of the world.
It made me who I am today, that trip to Cameroon.
And tell us all about that.
Initially, when I was at Bryn Mawr, it was kind of a plantation with the maids and porters, all black, who lived across the tracks or in attics.
Mm-hmm.
They were supposed to call us Miss. We were not supposed to call them by any title.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so these elders were Venus and Louise, and we were Miss. So.
Mm-hmm.
Africa was a nice balance for that. It changed the whole color spectrum.
First, tell me this. What was your reason for going there? How did you get to go to Cameroon?
Well, I just wanted to go someplace. Mm-hmm. It all started when I was four. I think that's when I started to become an anthropologist. I had an aunt who lived in Chinatown in New York, and she had no kids and no television.
Uh-huh.
And so I would look out of the window at the Chinese people.
Uh-huh.
And at that point, Chinatown was really Chinatown.
Yeah.
It had pagoda roofs
yeah.
and things.
Uh-huh.
And I was just fascinated by people who spoke a language I didn't understand.
Yeah.
I was learning how to read and write. There's a lot of writing in Chinatown.
Uh-huh.
But I couldn't, where's cat, where's dog? Where were the words and the letters I knew?
Right.
I loved to look at the restaurants with those naked ducks hanging by their neck. That was fascinating.
Uh-huh.
And so that made me know that there were other people, other places who did things differently.
Uh-huh.
And so I was always curious from then on about who's out there in the world doing something else. I had a feeling that Jersey wasn't everything.
It wasn't the end of the world.
Right.
Uh-huh.
There was more to it than that.
Okay.
So when I got to college, I chose a college that had a junior year abroad program so I could go someplace.
Uh-huh.
And someplace in that era was France.
Right.
It's okay. It was someplace else.
Right.
But I met an African-American diplomat who told me about the Experiment in International Living. And they had, well, most of their programs were to Europe, but they had one African country, and it was Cameroon.
Uh-huh.
And I thought, well, I'll just go to Cameroon.
Sure.
And it couldn't have been better.
What year is this?
64.
Okay.
Yeah, July 64. Okay. Couldn't have been better.
Mm-hmm.
It's a culturally rich country, very diverse,
mm-hmm.
and I lived in a kingdom.
Mm-hmm.
Had a king, had a palace.
Uh-huh.
King only had about 46 wives at the time.
Only.
Uh-huh. His father had many more.
Did he try to make you one of his wives?
Well, I was anticipating that.
Uh-huh.
No.
Mm.
I was a little disappointed.
Uh-huh. Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
I mean, I thought, you know, he could, like, offer.
Yeah.
No. But I did get some offers, of course.
Uh-huh.
Like the family I lived with, they had a son who was studying in the States.
Uh-huh.
And so they thought, he might want to bring one of them back. Let's choose her. So one day, he'd been there for about a week, so I still hardly knew him.
Right.
He said, I could be everything to you. Mm. And I said, what does that mean?
Mm-hmm. So
he said, well, I'm your brother, right?
Yeah.
Because you're living with my family.
Yeah.
I'm your grandfather.
Ooh.
I said, you're my grandfather? Because he had inherited the property
okay.
of his grandfather,
uh-huh.
And that also gave him symbolically his identity. So he became the grandfather to his own brothers and sisters and me. And so if I were to marry him, then he'd be everything.
Mercy. Okay.
Well, I didn't.
Yeah.
And that was okay. But the family was very conscious of Pan-Africanism. They knew about the civil rights struggle. They listened to all that on shortwave radio. And I said, well, why are you interested in that? In our civil rights struggle? And they said, it's the same struggle. Your civil rights and our independence. They had just been independent for 4 years in 1964. And that's when we had the Civil Rights Act. So there were parallels that they saw. I didn't see them. I didn't learn any of this in my fashionable Eastern women's school. They asked me, well, did you bring us any records? Now, I didn't acknowledge that I didn't think they knew about records or had electricity. And they said, well, if you didn't bring us any of your music, let us play some of your music for you.
Hello.
You want to hear Harry Belafonte? Maybe Ray Charles. What about Mahalia?
Okay. All right.
So they, right up front, let me know that they knew about a bigger world than I knew about. And I was part of this big world that they were interested in when they had...
Let me ask you something right there. Because there's something that I've noticed, I've observed. By and large, I'm going to stereotype, which is something one should not do, but I'm going to do it anyhow. By and large, Americans think, oftentimes, behave in a way, oftentimes, that the world ends between the Atlantic and the Pacific, and that we really know better than anybody else. And here you are as a college student traveling to Cameroon, just recently having gotten its independence, and you're with a family who actually seemed to me much more worldly than you were at that time.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Okay.
They asked me questions like, do you know Sparrow from Trinidad? What, well, maybe. What about Pelé from Brazil? Who? Where? So that's how I began to know there was an African diaspora. This Cameroonian family, my Cameroonian parents had not been, my Cameroonian mother had been to second grade, my Cameroonian father had been to high school.
Right.
And then at that point, that was a lot. And he became a teacher. And at the, when I was there, he was like the lieutenant governor of the
He really had it going on.
The region, yeah.
He's a teacher, lieutenant governor, he's the king.
No, he wasn't the king.
Oh,
no.
Okay.
But that was a relative. The king was a relative.
Okay, yeah. Okay, okay.
Oh, no, he wasn't the king, too. But that's that was exactly my experience. Here I am, I'm going to this fashionable college, you know, I'm supposed to be learning stuff.
Sure.
And these Africans know so much more about the world than I do. And they were determined they were going to teach me stuff. And they did. So that's where I began to become an African diasporan. And this was a time when those sociologists who studied us told us we African Americans didn't have any culture. If we had any culture, it was pathological. And we certainly didn't have any African culture, and why would we want it? It wasn't civilized.
Because if you watch the Tarzan movies, which were popular during that time.
Absolutely.
Why would you want African culture?
Right. Here's this white man who is smarter than all these Africans in their own environment.
That's right.
Well, I didn't meet him. He wasn't there.
Didn't see it?
No. But to talk a little bit about the king, the father of the king when I was there, who was, he was the king at the beginning of the 20th century, King Njoya, he's a legend.
Okay.
He created a writing system for his language.
Okay.
He wrote books in the writing system. He, he created schools in which his writings were taught. And when the French came to colonize, one of the first things they did was close his schools. And I thought, wasn't that like we weren't, during slavery, allowed to know how to read and write? He also built a palace out of traditional materials, but in a European style, and it's been restored by UNESCO. So this was a great place for me to start my African experiences. And they have a very rich artistic tradition. Lost wax bronze casting, beadwork, a lot of stuff.
What were you studying at Bryn Mawr?
Initially, I was studying political science because I thought, I wanted to travel. How do you travel? Yeah. Well, be a diplomat. Mm-hmm. Then when I got to Cameroon, I met some of the diplomats. Mm-hmm. The colored man was not there when I was there. There was one, but he was gone when I went to the embassy. I didn't think I wanted to work with these guys. Mm-hmm. I asked one man what he thought about Cameroonian food.
Yeah.
Just, you know, making conversation.
Sure.
And he'd only been there for 2 years, and he said, I think I've had some.
Mm.
In 2 years, he
right.
thought he'd had some. And what he thought he had had was some grilled meat,
uh-huh.
like
uh-huh.
grilled beef.
Right.
Cameroonian food is very rich.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, there's a lot of variety. It's
mm-hmm.
delicious.
Mm-hmm.
And that's where I began to learn about the cultural continuum from Africa to the Americas.
Uh-huh.
Initially, the family had, they would serve like French fries
yeah.
and grilled chicken, okay. stuff I was accustomed to.
Right.
And then suddenly one day,
uh-huh.
it was different. There was fufu
uh-huh.
and some kind of green sauce.
Yeah.
And I thought, the fufu looked like uncooked bread dough to
okay.
me.
Okay.
And I didn't like that sauce.
Right.
Well, eventually I fell in love with it.
Mm-hmm.
The fufu ceased to look like uncooked bread dough and mm-hmm. started to look like grits.
And so that first trip, how long did you stay?
2 months.
And when you came back to the States,
mm-hmm.
what was the difference in Sheila Walker from when she first left?
Totally different. First of all, the kind of questions that people asked me
mm-hmm.
were, well, did you live in a tribe?
Mm-hmm.
And that was, what's a tribe? That's what you see on Tarzan, right?
Yeah,
And I would say, no, I lived in a house
mm-hmm.
with hot running water, as a matter of fact,
mm-hmm.
okay?
Mm-hmm.
And we had servants,
yeah.
unlike in East Orange, New Jersey.
Yeah.
So I was living high.
Yeah.
I mean, it was when I look back at the house, it wasn't so fancy, but it
sure.
was fine.
Sure.
You know, it was, it wasn't what I expected. I thought I was going to live in something made out of mud bricks
mm-hmm.
With a thatch roof.
Mm-hmm.
Well, no, not at all.
Mm-hmm.
We had two vehicles.
Mm-hmm.
And one day I went for a walk with my Cameroonian brothers. And they just were showing me around the town. And I called it the village. And they kept correcting me,
mm-hmm.
the town.
Okay.
And I said, the village. This is a town. This is not a village.
Uh-huh.
Okay, what's the difference?
Right,
you know,
right,
it's Africa,
right.
It must be a village.
Sure.
They said, well, we have a hotel, we have a gas station,
uh-huh.
we have a hospital,
uh-huh.
we have administrative buildings.
Uh-huh.
This is a town.
Mm-hmm.
I realized, yeah, I guess it is a town. Plus, it had a palace.
Yeah.
And two museums, which
uh-huh.
we didn't have in East Orange, New Jersey.
Yeah.
So that kind of put me in my place and made me, well, first of all, just being there, living with these people who were so hospitable,
mm-hmm.
made me want to travel more,
mm-hmm.
see who else was out there.
Right.
And I expected the same sort of reception, positive reception,
mm-hmm.
and generally I've gotten it because mm-hmm. I guess I expect that.
Mm-hmm.
When I came back and had one more year of college. I was too busy just trying to get out of there. I switched
sure.
my major from political science because meeting the diplomats,
uh-huh.
I thought, I don't want to work with these guys.
Yeah, yeah.
I want to be in Cameroon with Cameroonians.
Uh-huh.
If I go to Peru, I want to be in Peru with Peruvians.
Okay.
I don't want to go and stay in the U.S. bubble.
Yeah.
So I found out about anthropology. I
uh-huh.
met an anthropologist who was there.
Uh-huh.
And he was talking about the research he was doing. And I thought, oh, that sounds good. That's another way to travel. And that way I can do what I want. I won't represent a government.
Mm-hmm.
I only represent me.
Mm-hmm.
And this Cameroonian family put me on that path.
Mm.
Not just by introducing me to the anthropologist, but by making me want to know more.
Uh-huh.
And we had a party. And I thought, oh, wow, African drums, African
yeah.
you know, costumes and
sure.
stuff. Wrong.
Uh-huh.
Wrong.
Uh-huh.
The music was Afro-Cuban.
Yeah.
And they said, how come you can dance to our music? I said, that's not your music. I dance to this in Jersey.
Yeah.
And we were a group.
Uh-huh.
And the other people in the group were not African-Americans.
Mm-hmm.
And the Cameroonians are like, well, how come you can dance? And what's wrong with them?
Uh-huh. Uh-huh.
And that was a moment of, She's one of ours.
Mm-hmm.
I think that party
mm-hmm.
and the dancing
mm-hmm.
was a real revelation
mm-hmm.
to them. It's like, uh-huh, well,
There was a connection.
Yeah, yeah.
So you come back, you switch your major, you have another year, excuse me, and then There is the yearning. Then there is the yearning to start this diaspora thing.
Well, I had to go to graduate school first.
Okay.
So I went to graduate school in cultural anthropology. Mm-hmm. And there, I was kind of between two tendencies. Mm. Anthropology is a colonial science.
Mm-hmm.
The colonials studied the natives so as to know how to better control them.
Mm-hmm.
To see the evolution of humanity, the natives being at a lower level of evolution mm-hmm. than the European mm-hmm. anthropologists, presumably.
Mm-hmm.
But I thought, I didn't know that. Mm-hmm. I just thought, oh, wow, you know, I mm-hmm. get to hang out with more people like these interesting Cameroonians.
Mm-hmm.
But this was also the 60s, right? Yeah. This is the beginning of Black power.
Yeah.
This is Black militancy.
Yeah. Yeah.
So here I have these colonial white professors, all mm-hmm. male, mm-hmm. by definition at that point.
Mm-hmm.
And the militants are saying, nah, hey, sister, now, are you Black or are you not?
Yeah, yeah.
Well, yeah, of course.
Mm-hmm.
But what was Black? Now, for them, the Black was more narrow than I had just learned in Cameroon.
Mm-hmm.
So Cameroon mm-hmm. helped me defend myself
mm-hmm.
against these my professors who were still trying to tell us we didn't have any culture.
Yes.
And the militants who were trying to be too narrow. Because
uh-huh.
I spent a year in Paris after Cameroon,
yeah.
and I hung out with Black folks from all kinds of places.
So now you refer to as the militants.
Mm-hmm.
So what about their ideology made them too narrow?
Well, I want to go skiing. Black folks don't ski.
Uh-huh.
Mm-hmm. Well, but why?
Yeah, right. Okay.
I want to go eat some Greek food. Mm-hmm. No, that ain't Black.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but why? You know, I want to be in the world.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
And I had experienced that.
Mm-hmm.
In Paris, I hung out with Afro-Cubans, mm-hmm. people from various places in the Caribbean, mm-hmm. various kinds of Africans from different places.
And this was at Chicago University.
Mm-hmm.
Did you feel as if you were a misfit?
Well, I felt that I would be much more appreciated than I was.
Mm-hmm.
I thought that there'd be more appreciation among these anthropologists mm-hmm. for my culture.
Yeah.
I wanted to do my doctoral dissertation on elements of African American culture.
Uh-huh.
And so when I met with the professors, one of them said, well, give me an example of some African American culture. And I said, well, the dozens.
Yeah.
And he said, the dozens are dead. Now, a friend of mine said, he better come over to the hood and tell my kids that the dozens are dead. Because they be playing the dozens mm-hmm. on a regular basis.
Mm-hmm. Your mama be coming off their lips on a regular basis.
Right.
Okay.
So I was in this very unsupportive environment for...
Did he have any idea what you meant when you said the dozens? And then for him to say that the dozens are dead?
That's a good point.
Uh-huh.
He's the expert.
Yeah.
Of course he did.
Uh-huh.
I mean, did he really know? I don't know.
Uh-huh. Uh-huh.
But I also what I learned was these are the people who are going to decide my fate. So for me to write about African American culture that they're trying to convince me doesn't exist is like sending the fox to get the chickens.
So you find yourself in a very interesting position.
Yeah. Yeah.
So tell me how you navigated that, because I hear you. I think I hear you. I think I hear you saying to tell your truth,
mm-hmm.
you know that the truth that you're telling is more than likely going to get slapped down.
Absolutely.
And you're on a mission to get a PhD.
Right.
So what did you do?
Fortunately, I met Prince Charming.
Uh-huh.
And Prince Charming, at that point, had a choice between peace and war. Get drafted, go to Vietnam, or join the Peace Corps.
Uh-huh.
So, being a smart man,
okay.
Prince Charming chose the Peace Corps.
Uh-huh.
Went to Ivory Coast.
Mm.
You don't meet Prince Charming every day, so I thought, well, I was going to go to Brazil. Brazil will be there. I'll go to Ivory Coast.
Uh-huh.
And so I studied a church in Ivory Coast, and something non-threatening.
Uh-huh.
And I wrote about that.
Mm-hmm.
And it was an African Christian church, a church that was founded by an African who'd been, Christianized by missionaries.
Interesting world we live in.
Right.
Then and now.
Oof.
Yeah. Let me ask you something. You said in the African Christianity, and they preach. Two questions. One, was there a white Jesus in the church? And two, how was the preaching different than what you might have been used to in the States?
There was no white Jesus.
There was not?
There was no Jesus.
Uh-huh.
Because it seems that the understanding was that the creator, and that there was a God, there was a picture of God, a painting of God, and he was white, the white man with the white hair. So I guess that was God. Mm-hmm. But God had several sons. And since Jesus was white, he went to France. Harris, the African, was God's son for the Africans. So uh-huh. he was the prophet for the Africans. Uh-huh. And what this was about was essentially Africans saying, okay, these people, these Europeans have essentially conquered us, so they must have some really strong juju, and we better learn it.
That's a strong juju.
Yeah, mm-hmm. yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm. And so let's learn their version of spirituality. Mm-hmm. Not all of it, though. Mm-hmm. No, I mean, we don't want to learn those songs. No, we got our own songs, and we have to have some rhythm yeah. with our songs.
Yeah.
And so the style, I mean, they would break out into song. Mm-hmm. They would have a procession to church with mm-hmm. you know, a little rhythm mm-hmm. and some instruments. Mm-hmm. So it was lively. You know, it wasn't like what the missionaries had intended. Uh-huh. This was African Christianity. And mm-hmm. one of the big movements in Africa is Christianity. Mm-hmm. Now, Christ isn't in it necessarily. Uh-huh. I mean, I talked about this to some theologians and they said, wait a minute, you said it's Christianity. Mm-hmm. Well, where's Christ?
Yeah.
Like, well, he's just not there. Mm-hmm. Harris is the prophet. Mm-hmm. But they consider themselves Christian, so it's not up to me to mm-hmm. decide that they're not just because mm-hmm. there's no Christ. Mm-hmm. But essentially, what they were preaching was, let me see, they had been conquered by these Europeans, so colonialism had begun.
Yeah.
How were they going to adjust to it? Uh-huh. So this was a way of adopting uh-huh. a colonial uh-huh. Institution uh-huh. and trying to put it to the service of their own issues.
Uh-huh. Now, those who are advanced in Christianity have done more of a job since then, because today in churches in Africa, you see a white Jesus.
Uh-huh, yeah. That's a problem.
Yeah,
it seems to be.
Okay, so you're there, and so where was your? Tell us about your journey. After there, you went, and now you really got this diaspora bug. Okay.
Yeah. Well, while I was in Africa, I traveled all over the place okay. by all kinds of means, uh-huh. and I got to know people from other places, uh-huh. and so then I needed to visit them. So I went to the Caribbean, to Martinique, Guadeloupe. Well, if I'm going to go that far, I might as well go to Brazil, uh-huh. right? And okay. Colombia. So yeah. initially, I didn't know about all the black folks in so many places.
Okay.
There was a conference in Colombia in 1977 mm-hmm. in Cali on the Pacific coast of Colombia. Now, okay, Colombia has a Caribbean coast. Makes sense to me that they're black folks. Mm-hmm. Pacific Ocean? Black mm-hmm. folks? Mm-hmm. We went to a town called Buenaventura,
yeah.
a coastal town,
yeah.
and I thought I was in Africa. And to make things more complex, this Afro-Colombian came and started talking to me in perfect Ebonics. Mm-hmm. And I said, how did you learn to talk like us? Where are you from? I'm from here. How'd you learn to talk like us? Merchant Marines, African-American merchant Marines, taking African-American culture mm-hmm. around the world.
Uh-huh. Uh-huh.
That was startling to me. But to be on the Pacific coast mm-hmm. of South America, mm-hmm. and to think I was in Africa, and yeah. I met an Afro-Ecuadorian, yeah. and I said, I didn't know there were black folks in Ecuador.
Yeah.
He said, dance with me, sister, then you'll know there uh-huh. are black folks in Ecuador.
Uh-huh.
Wow.
Wow.
What an answer.
Yeah.
So having met these folks, then I figured, well, gotta find, where else are we?
Yeah.
I went to a conference in Argentina, and there was a big reception at a fancy place. And I said, are there any Afro-Argentinians here?
Yeah.
The conference was about black culture, mm-hmm. But as appropriated by white Argentinians who religiously have become Yoruba.
Yeah.
Okay. So are there any black, are there any Afro-Argentinians here? There's one. So I went over and said, eres Argentina. Uh-huh. Soy Argentina, existes, existo. So she exists uh-huh. as an Afro-Argentinian.
Yeah.
And then with her, I met people from Uruguay, and then with them, I met people from Paraguay. Uh-huh. So I just kept meeting all these folks from various places in the Americas. Chile, there's not a country where we're not.
Okay, so you kept meeting these folks. Tell us about your visits. I mean, you, Brazil, Ecuador, India. Tell us about, we have a video. I think we played early the video, but I think we have one from Brazil.
Mm-hmm.
Tell us about that experience.
Well, I went to Brazil to spend 2 weeks.
Yeah.
And I spent 2 weeks and 3 months.
Uh-huh.
I went to Bahia.
Okay.
And I had intended to go to Brazil to do my dissertation research, but then I went to Ivory Coast because of Prince Charming. Mm-hmm. But I still had to satisfy Brazil. And why did I have to go to Brazil? It was all because of seeing them ladies get happy in church in Newark, New Jersey, and not understanding this issue of the spirit. What is this spirit?
Yeah.
Why does the spirit act like that? So I figured I'd read about Brazil and the Afro-Brazilian religion, and I thought there are some answers there. I went to Brazil. I went to Bahia. that Bahia casts a spell on you. Well, the spell worked.
On you?
On me. After 2 weeks, I said, well, I'm leaving now, maybe in another week. And at the end of that week, well, I really have to go.
What was it that was holding you?
Maybe in another week. The religion, the food, it was such an African place in the Americas. Uh-huh. Plus, I was, there was so much mystery to learn about, because here is mainly Yoruba religion that's been recreated in the Americas. Mm-hmm. It wasn't the kind of stripped down Protestantism that we have. You know, we got the music, we got the getting happy.
Yeah.
But they have outfits, they have food, they have drums, they have ceremonies, spiritual beings enter into the bodies of people, just like when people are filled with the spirit in our churches, right? Well, there, when I saw the getting happy in Hopewell Baptist Church in Newark, New Jersey, I wanted to know, where does the spirit come from? Why does spirit act like this? What's the spirit's name?
Mm-hmm.
There were no answers to that. Mm-hmm. In Bahia, the spirit came from Africa. The spirit's name was Iemanjá or Xangô or Oshun. Why did the spirit dance? The spirit was dancing his or her role in the cosmos. That was pretty fascinating stuff to me.
Mm-hmm.
So I had to, every time I got to know a little bit, I had to try to get to know a little bit more.
Mm-hmm.
So finally, after two weeks and 3 months, I had to go back to my job.
Let me ask them why you were there. Because you're talking about the spirit.
Mm-hmm.
So as you are observing this, did you internalize any of it? Did you ever get the Holy Ghost?
I wondered if I was going to get that. No, it never happened.
Okay.
But one of the things that the priestesses and priests, and there are more priestesses, will tell you who your guardian and guiding orishas are, the Yoruba spiritual beings.
Mm-hmm.
So they tell you that, or they throw cowrie shells, they do divination, so that you have a sense of who's supposed to be guiding you and taking care of you, and what your characteristics are supposed to be like. It's kind of like us in the zodiac. For example, if a man's orisha is Ogun, he will be expected to be maybe into technology, maybe into things involving war, of being a cop or a soldier. But he could be a computer programmer too, or an inventor of mechanical things, because Ogun was in charge of iron technology. A woman who's very vain. People would assume that her orisha just might be Oshun, because Oshun is very vain, likes gold, very sensuous. So they have characteristics. So I was just fascinated by all this, because it was so much, there was so much more pageantry, so much more meaning, and it's part of everyday life. People will just meet you and say, oh, your orisha must be.
Did you attend church when you got back from Brazil after that experience?
I've never been a regular churchgoer, but yeah, sometimes.
Did you find yourself yawning?
I like to go to lively churches.
Okay.
But our churches are a little one-dimensional as compared to what goes on in Brazil. You know, we're not dancing around in circles to drums with outfits on.
So you now are somewhere in your 30s around that time?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And you are making this connection that there is serious connection. All of these different places that you're visiting mm-hmm. back to the continent.
Absolutely, absolutely. And I could, it was so, having gone to Ivory Coast rather than Brazil and having traveled around in various places in Africa mm-hmm. allowed me to just recognize stuff. Mm-hmm. I remember walking into one candomblé, that's what the Afro-Brazilian, one of the terms used for the Afro-Brazilian religion in Bahia. There's a lot of variety in the Afro-Brazilian religion, but mm-hmm. so let's, I like to be as specific as possible. I walked into a compound of one of the major candomblé houses. Mm-hmm. The smells took me to Africa. Mm. Just the smells, the look of the land. So the fact of having been to a lot of places in Africa just made things familiar, recognizable. Mm-hmm. And that was, my world was getting so much bigger. Mm-hmm. And it was all my world. You know, these are the same people who get the spirit in Newark, New Jersey. Mm-hmm. Then, though, I was still Atlantic.
Yeah.
You know, I just knew about the Americas. Mm-hmm. And I was feeling very, very enhanced mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. by knowing about the Americas. So it's mm-hmm. very hard for me to just talk about the United States because I'm always spilling beyond the borders.
Yeah.
Then in 2004, I got an email about a conference on the African diaspora in Asia to be held in Goa in India. Mm. I was thrilled. Mm-hmm. I almost bought a plane ticket right away, mm-hmm. except it would have been a year too early mm-hmm. because I got this invitation in 2004. The thing was in 2006. Mm. Mm. So. But I couldn't wait to go to India.
Yeah.
Wow. You know, I'd heard that there were Afro-Indians.
Sure.
But hearing and seeing mm-hmm. are totally different. Mm-hmm. And I harassed the organizer terribly because he said, well, there are going to be visits after, so you can go here, you can go here. Can I go to all these places? With how far are they from each other? Is there time to go to all of them? Mm-hmm. And he said, calma. He'll figure it out. Mm-hmm. Now, I know better. I know I can't know in advance.
Yeah.
I know that when I get there, stuff is going to happen.
Yeah, yeah.
And
yeah.
I'll get to go to more places than I have time to go to, and I'll need to go back. Mm-hmm. But India was great. So the conference was in
India
Goa.
India was great. What yeah. stands out?
Oh, color. There are, I don't know, 300 zillion people in India. Mm-hmm. The women all wear a garment that is similar. Mm-hmm. To us, there are all these different ways of tying it. Mm-hmm. I don't know. Mm-hmm. I don't recognize all the different ways. They, mm-hmm. No two women I saw out of the 300 zillion people mm-hmm. had the same pattern on. Mm. They all looked totally different. Mm-hmm. So, just the.
I heard my wife spent 6 weeks in Kerala and then some other parts.
Yeah.
And she and Dick Gregory. We're having a conversation. They must have talked 15 or 20 minutes about the aroma,
mm-hmm.
about the smell, mm-hmm. about the aroma mm-hmm. of India mm-hmm. and how it was unlike anything else in the world.
Mm-hmm.
You're shaking your head.
Oh, yeah.
Tell me about it.
Oh, I love Indian food.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I had Indian food for breakfast, lunch, and dinner mm-hmm. all the time. I understood why those Europeans braved sea monsters mm-hmm. to go look for some spices. Mm-hmm. I mean, they knew there were sea monsters, mm-hmm. right? But over there were those spices that made stuff delicious. Mm-hmm. So, yeah.
So in India, mm-hmm. in India, how much did colonization cause normal Indian population to look down on Africa? If at all.
Yeah, I think most Indians don't know anything about Africans or even notice that there are Afro-Indian populations. I think India is just so Indian
mm-hmm.
that colonization influenced a small group.
Mm-hmm.
It's like being in Nigeria, mm-hmm. you know, mm-hmm. same British colonization. Mm-hmm. It's so Nigerian. Mm-hmm. So I think that my impression was that India was the same, that it was just Indian. Mm-hmm. And Indian in so many ways that I knew I wouldn't ever understand anything. Mm-hmm. They have something like 16 official languages mm-hmm. with different writing systems, and it all looks like beautiful embroidery. Mm-hmm.
You are weaving. You're sort of weaving Africa as you go. You're kind of knitting. You're kind of knitting a quilt, and you're mm-hmm. in Brazil, and you're in India, and you're in Paraguay, and you're in South Carolina. You're in South Carolina.
Yeah.
What have you experienced in your journey that has made you sad about exploring the African diaspora?
Well, I was sad this year. I went to Paraguay. And I went to Paraguay because I wanted to attend the Feast for St. Balthazar, mm-hmm. King St. Balthazar, the African magus, the African wise man mm-hmm. who visited baby Jesus. Mm-hmm. And in the Americas, the only African diaspora community that has him as their patron saint and has a celebration for him.
What's his name again?
Balthazar.
Balthazar, okay.
Yeah, mm-hmm. What is it? Melchior, Gaspar, and Balthazar. Mm-hmm. So only this group of Afro-Paraguayans celebrates him mm-hmm. on January 6th, Three Kings Day, Epiphany. Mm-hmm. So I've been saying, oh, I really need to go, I really need to go. Well, at some point you just have to go. Yeah. What made me sad about them was here is this very small group. There are three separate Afro-Paraguayan groups, but the one that's near the capital is the most dynamic one. Mm-hmm. There are very few of them, so they have to outmarry. Otherwise, they'd have to marry their sister or their cousin. Mm-hmm. So they are losing their Afro-phenotype. Mm-hmm. So they're becoming
outmarry, meaning
marry somebody outside their community. Uh-huh, uh-huh. So they're losing their phenotype, mm-hmm. and their little neighborhood mm-hmm. is being squeezed and squeezed and squeezed. So mm-hmm. they're losing their land. Mm-hmm. And I wonder how long they will continue to have a specific identification mm-hmm. as Afro-Paraguayans. Mm-hmm. What I found fascinating was I suddenly realized that they're the only group in the Americas that has a name for themselves that is an African ethnic name. They're called Kamba. Mm-hmm. And one of them would say, yes, we Kamba, we black people, mm-hmm. nosotros negros. Mm-hmm. Now, he wasn't terribly negro, but mm-hmm. you know, because of the miscegenation. So that made me sad, because I wondered, are they going to survive as a group? And the whole southern cone of South America, Paraguay, Bolivia, Argentina, Chile, mm-hmm. the groups are very small, and they're losing an identifiable Afro-phenotype. Mm-hmm. So they're becoming conscious mm-hmm. of their African origins mm-hmm. as they're looking less and less like their African ancestors and are less and less subject to the kind of discrimination that was a product of being brown,
typically,
curly hair.
When one thinks of a Bolivian, they do not think of dark.
Right.
You spent time there. Tell us about that journey.
Well, the first Bolivian I met him in New York, and he said, I'm Juan Angola Maconde from Bolivia. We have no African culture. Mm. So I looked at this very chocolate man mm-hmm. with very African kind of hair, and I said, you invented the name. He said, oh no, there are a lot of Angolas and a lot of Macondes as family names. Mm-hmm. So, well, how do you manage to have no African culture with mm-hmm. all those names? Mm-hmm. Now, they're another case, though. They don't have a lot of identifiable African culture mm-hmm. because they're a very small population mm-hmm. and they have been surrounded by indigenous people for forever. Mm-hmm. Their music dance style, for example, now they still have drums, mm-hmm. they still dance. They were getting away from it in their desire to assimilate, but then as a result of the consciousness raising mm-hmm. that in the late 90s, early 2000s, they have reclaimed their dance step. Mm-hmm. And I had only seen young people do it, and they have, you know, some moves, mm-hmm. but I wanted to see the old people. What did they do? Well, they're pretty static. Mm-hmm. I mean, they're not, you know, they don't have the moves. Yeah. And I think that's the indigenous influence. Well, I played some of the music for a Congolese musician, and he said, "Oh yeah, they're missing a drum. There's one rhythm missing." But if you were to hear that rhythm, you would hear the Africanity of what they're doing. And they're conscious now of maintaining their identity, expressing it through music and dance. And one of the things that I have video from all these places in the world, and I was looking over my video, and I thought, the stereotype is true. Every place we are singing and dancing. And that is true. And I thought, well, isn't that a little trivial just to sing and dance? Then I read an article written by a Congolese linguist, and he was talking about Congo Square and the music, singing, dancing, drumming that went on in Congo Square in Louisiana. And he, one of the dances in colonial Congo Square was the bambula. And he put that, he said, this is a Bantu word, a Kikongo word from the Congo Kingdom. And he put it in the context of a phrase that I can't cite, that meant we are dancing so as not to forget. We are dancing so as to remember our ancestors. And what he said was that this music and dancing is colonizing African space in the Americas. Well, that takes it to a whole new level. I mean, that makes music and dance not just fun, but also a connector with roots. And even if we don't know what we're doing, we're all doing something very similar all over the place.
Which brings me right to the next. You have a book. Your book is called African Roots, American Culture. Why did you write that?
Because I had to.
And what message do you want the reader to get from it?
I organized a conference. I used to teach, I directed the Center for African and African American Studies at the University of Texas at Austin. And I got some money from UNESCO and organized a conference on the African diaspora and the modern world. And I invited people from South America, as well as major scholars from Africa, US, various places. And one of the people from South America said, well, I'll talk about discrimination and how oppressed we are. And I said, no, not here. Oh, no, no, I'm sick of that narrative. No, this is about, no, we don't do victims here. No, you're not gonna come to cry. I'm not sending you a plane ticket for that. What I asked you to talk about was contributions of Afro-Uruguayans to the nation. I asked you to talk about what is your culture? How do you identify Afro-Uruguayan culture? Oh, okay, and he did a very good job. But the message is that Africa contributed to the creation of the Americas, and not just on the level of music and dance, but also on the level of music and dance. One fact I learned at this conference I organized was the demographics of the Americas. Until the beginning of the 1800s, 6.5 million people crossed the Atlantic Ocean from Europe and Africa to come to the Americas. 6.5 million. 1 million came from Europe. 5.5 million came from Africa. So that means for over 300 years, almost everybody in the Americas, the Native Americans having been genocided, almost everybody in the Americas was African and African descendant. Well, then how can you even think about talking about the history of the Americas without the huge majority of the population? So there's that. There's the technology, gold. When Europeans discovered the gold of the indigenous people, they didn't know how to extract it. So what did they do? They went to what they called a costa da mina, the gold coast, now Ghana, and got Africans they knew, knew mining, metallurgy. And they called them negros minas. So mining black folks in Brazil, in Ecuador, Colombia.
You are an anthropologist. You're an educator. Having this vast experience about the diaspora and how in every corner of the universe, every corner of the world, Africans exist. The United States is supposed to be the most advanced country. What does it say about its educational system that it has so significantly eliminated Africa from its textbooks?
Well, I think that the issue is a lack of desire to tell the truth. Now, I don't know when I learned about slavery, but it wasn't, I didn't learn about it a long time ago. So I wasn't ashamed a bit of it. I wasn't mad. I just didn't know anything, which is shocking because the economic basis of the Americas is African.
Right.
The Industrial Revolution was done by, was the result of all that free African labor. And the reparations paid to Europeans at the end of slavery and what was called compensated emancipation. So if we don't know that, then we don't know the story. We don't know how we got here. And that's totally, I mean, if you, that means our educational system is really teaching lies if it's not teaching the truth. I think there are only two possibilities, the truth or lies. So to the extent that you leave out such a huge part of the story, then you're, why are you hiding the truth? What do you want us to not know? Why don't you tell us that Africans were specifically recruited for knowledge and technology? Rice, we started with the Geechees and the Gullah. Rice culture in the United States is African. The rice that was brought to the South Carolina, Georgia, Louisiana is African rice. Rice domesticated in Africa is not Asian rice. It's a whole other species of rice. And they, planters would ask ship captains to bring rice Negroes because they had the technology. Rice was the first food commodity traded in the Atlantic world. And this is rice from the Senegambia, rice from the Niger River, rice from Sierra Leone, from the grain coast. If we were taught that, we would have a different kind of self-image. We would understand that we were not just, what, stoop labor. We were brought not just as bodies, but as minds. And these minds all over the Americas helped develop the Americas. The gold, I mean, that gold, what did it do? It enriched Europe. The foods, there are so many places in which African foods are still eaten with African names intact. Mondongo. Mondongo is tripe. You can eat something called mondongo. I had, where was I? In a Colombian restaurant in New York. I had some mondongo, because that's from Angola. Mondongo, the kingdom of Mondongo. I've eaten mondongo as a cultural experience. From Argentina to Mexico. If we knew the real story, we would, we as African descendants, we would feel better about ourselves. We would have much more attitude. We would think we were much more entitled to everything, all the goodies of the society. And but to keep us in the dark.
Personal and collective self-esteem.
It's empowering to know your story, and it's disempowering to be told, like they tried to teach me when I was in graduate school, that everybody had a culture but us. Everybody but us.
I ask you, in your experience and in your travel, and as you knitted the quilt of the diaspora, what made you sad? We've got about 2 minutes left. Tell me your greatest joys.
Wow. Well, to go to Karnataka in India and see these people who look just like they could be on Howard's campus, and to have them look at me and say, oh, she's one of our people. I have a picture of this Afro-Indian holding a cake that says President Obama, because they had a party for him when he won. I went to Turkey. And I was hanging out with Afro-Turks who looked like they'd be perfectly at home on Howard's campus. And they had a party for President Obama. And I said, well, why do you like this man? Well, he's our blood. In Karnataka, in India, they called him an American Sindhi because all the Afro-Indians mm-hmm. collectively are referred to as Sindhis. So okay. Obama's an American Sindhi. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so I am struck by the fact that we have a sense of us-ness mm-hmm. All over the place. We may not know the details, mm-hmm. but there's a Nicolas Guillen, Afro-Cuban poet, has a poem, the refrain of which is, sin conocernos nos reconoceremos. Without knowing each other, we will recognize each other. Mm-hmm. And I love that idea. Mm-hmm. Because we do, we recognize each other. Yeah. We see commonalities, and we want to know more about each other and our commonalities. Mm-hmm. I think for us to know, I showed a film that I did for the UNESCO Slavery Project to some kids in Brooklyn. And this film talks about Afro-Indians and talks about Afro-descendants all around the world. Mm-hmm. And one kid said, they left out some of the story. Why didn't they tell us the good parts? Why didn't they tell us that Africans were rulers mm-hmm. in India? Mm-hmm. Why don't they want us to know that? Mm-hmm. Why don't they want us to know we're every place? Mm-hmm. Well, it's empowering to know that you're every place. Yeah. It's empowering to know that you're global. It's empowering to know that there are 200 million African descendants in the Americas, yeah. in the Americas, from Argentina to Chile. Yeah. So I figure, and this all began with this nice family in Cameroon, mm-hmm. that this is my extended family.
Yeah. It is empowering
yeah.
that you have joined that you have joined us here today. Thank you so very much.
You're welcome.
That wraps us for this evening, folks. For more information on this program or any other program produced by WHUT, go to WHUT.org. I'm Rock Newman. God bless you, and we'll see you the next time.
This program was produced by WHUT, Howard University Television, and made possible by contributions from viewers like you. Thank you.